Hi, Caroline Magerl. I'm so excited to talk to you today. Before we kick off though, I did want to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the lands on which I live, work and create, and that is the Dja Dja Wurrung people. And I also want to pay my respects to the custodians, traditional custodians of the lands on which you live, work and create, and to pay our respects to their elders, past, present and emerging. All right, Caroline, there's so much to talk about. So I'm not sure where to begin, but I do have this little tiny bio and I'll share that with our viewers and our listeners, and that will kick us off into our discussion. So Caroline Magerl was born near Frankfurt in Germany and came to Australia when she was 2. She lived on the yacht her family built until she was 14. That in itself is a book. In 2001, which let me flag that, I think that's around the time that you and I met, Caroline won the CBCA Crichton Award for New Talent in Children's Book Illustration for her picture book, Grandma's Shoes, which was written by Libby Hathorne. Nowadays, Caroline is a big jump forward there, but nowadays she is a full-time artist, illustrator and printmaker. Piano Fingers, which we're going to talk about quite a bit in this interview, Piano Fingers is Caroline's latest book and it's published with Walker Books Australia. So Caroline, for everybody listening, I want to go right back to the start because it's so fascinating. Your childhood is so fascinating. And I'd like to just go through that with you and reflect on how that formed you as an artist, because clearly it had a fairly big impact on you. So can you walk us through what that was like and how that came about, that you lived on a yacht from the age of 2 to 14?
Okay. So what happened was, it was actually from the age of 7. It was when I arrived in Australia from Germany. My parents had this determination that they would write their own rules. I don't think they had a plan as to how that was going to happen. It just so happened that my father was a welder, and when he got to Sydney, there were people all around building yachts in backyards. Sydney was a very different place. And someone said to him, "Hey, why don't you build a yacht?" And he's like, "Well, why not?" So, yeah. So he built a yacht in the backyard of the place where we were renting with 4 other people. This is a Hungarian woman who'd carved up a house in Willoughby, and she was basically the first port of call for migrants and folks who were just blowing into Sydney and blowing out again. Like, for example, there was a guy who he worked on sheep stations and stuff, and when he'd come to Sydney, he'd stay with her. And there was some businessman too. He was living there. He was a bachelor, and his thing was at the end of the week he wouldn't wash his clothes. He'd burn them in the backyard, and then just buy a new set. So it was like a weird place, and we were there all in one room. My auntie, my mother, my father, myself, and my father decided to start building this yacht. I mean, 45-foot steel yacht in that backyard, which was kind of cheeky, I think. And so obviously at a certain point, I think that the landlord went, well, you know what? And so we moved out to Seven Hills, which was the edge of the bush in those days. And he finished the yacht there. It took from when I was about 3 to when I was 7, and that's when it was launched in the Parramatta River with, like, a pretty much nothing much in it, and no beds, no toilets, no any of that stuff. And over the next 3 years, we moved aboard while it was still pretty basic, and Dad just finished it off and lined it with plywood, and it was very, very basic life, no hot running water, 12-volt power, very dim lights, a tiny, tiny TV set that didn't really work because the boat was moving, so watching TV which is part of my creative journey, because, in some ways I think I had to entertain myself an awful lot.
Absolutely. I mean, there's just so many facets to that experience, right, from the migrant experience and being thrown into, and I can really see that, in which one is it? In Mire and Cat, I really, really can see that it's really got that vibe of that sort of migrant experience and that loneliness and trying to connect.
It does mark you.
It's beautiful. Yeah. 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 So one, was your father a waterman?
No. Basically, he grew up in a tiny brown coal mining town in East Germany, so a long way from the water, a very, very long way from the water. But he used to read this German novelist who never actually travelled anywhere but wrote a lot of stories about Alaska and exciting places and adventures. And my father gobbled up those stories. And I think that, in a weird way, I think that probably shaped his idea of who he wanted to be. Plus, he didn't want to go into the brown coal mine and, live like his father had, who was just like, just liked to drink, and he was a party guy, he used to play at parties, play the zither, play the accordion. Anyway, yeah. Another life of dad.
I know.
The dad used to sort of basically dig him out of snowdrifts after he'd ride home on the bicycle after having had a couple beers. Look, seriously, it was just really strange because it was German occupied, so there wasn't much to, in East Germany stayed that way for a really long time. It wasn't much to do but drink and party. All that was explained to me when I finally got there and I finally got to see the place, and I understood my father a lot better after that.
Okay, yeah.
And why he wanted to leave. Under every circumstance, that was it. He wanted to get out of there. And my mother, who was on the west side, she was an orphan, and she wanted out of Germany. The two of them had this burning desire to just leave. And so that was how the whole weird, like, why the boat made sense.
Did you know? Yes, absolutely. The ultimate escape. And also to the other side of the world and into sunshine.
Yes.
What year are we talking here? So what year was it when you came out?
66.
So 66.
Yeah.
And so 7 years later you moved onto the yacht. So in the early 70s.
Yeah.
And so in terms of your artistic development, so were either of your parents an influence in that, or was that something that you stumbled into because you needed something to do? And how did you have the art materials and things? Like, who gave them to you? Like, how did they come to you? I'm really interested in that nuts and bolts sort of stuff.
Look, my mother, I think she probably could draw. She just didn't really take it up. She loved fashion. That's what she loved, which was hilarious because, living on a boat, she had actual cocktail frocks, beautiful ones, in the cupboard on the boat. And I used to look at them and go, where are we going? What sort of life is it? She was stylish. And, that was probably her area of creativity and of expression. I think I was a bit thinky, so for me it was books and art. So that was my thing. And then my mother's, on my mother's side, her dad was actually a sculptor. He was trained in the Erzgebirge as a toy maker back in the day when, making wooden toys for people. That's what,
beautiful.
He was actually a sculptor, but he earned his living making sculptures for churches. So in Nuremberg, in the Frauenkirche or the Lorenzkirche, one of the two of them, he carved some of the Jesus on the cross and praying hands and all sorts of stuff like that. So he was very skilled. That was his, but he had another side to him. He really was quite political, and he used to actually make snow sculptures in his front yard of the local politicians that he hated. Yeah, and I eventually became a cartoonist, and I didn't realise that he, so there you go.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Anyway, so as far as, art materials and stuff, I had pencils and paper. That's it. And really, it was much later that I began to kind of really explore paint and all that. Like, I was in my 20s by that time.
While you were in your childhood, painting and drawing was basically just something that you did. It wasn't something that you thought, I'm going to be an artist. You didn't consciously think that.
No, I wanted to be a marine biologist. I wanted to be a lighthouse keeper. I wanted to be a hermit when I was 14, understandable entirely. And then I eventually wanted to be a chef, and I began to train in that field.
So also, like, we're just skipping around everywhere, but you have had such a fascinating background, and you were such an adventurer while you were young, and you were involved in so many, you know, you went places and did things, and it was amazing. And so was there a turning point when you thought art is the thing? Was there something or someone that sort of directed you or sort of pushed you in that direction? Or
That was a really strange thing, because I always wrote and drew. And then when I turned 14, I stopped writing. I just stopped. It was like I ran away from home. Life became very difficult, and I stopped. I started doing art, and I realise now that probably what it was art is a way you can say things without actually saying things. People always say my work's rather emotive. It's sublimated. That's what it is.
Yeah.
I at the time, you know, I didn't realise that. I did it because it was, yeah, I clamped down and stopped. I stopped communicating, you know, verbally in a sort of a more, you know, way of in which I was communicating with people. I just didn't do that. I did it with art. It's a really strange thing, and I find that fascinating, because I find people's reasons for doing creative work fascinating, and it is very it's a very telling thing if you start to really, you know, really look at it.
Yeah.
I'm getting a bit serious, but
no, it's fascinating. I think
that's what happened. So basically, I kept doing art. I began to realize I really wanted to do picture books, because I love picture books. Picture books were for me the first point that I saw art, felt art, related to art, felt that it was a powerful way of expressing things. I adored the picture books that my grandmother sent me from East Germany. I love them.
That's a really interesting little nugget too. So your grandmother was sending picture books, and so here you are on the yacht with these European PBs.
Exactly.
What a world.
They were formative. Were, in fact, the one thing that kind of laid out the course of my life, because they showed me that an artist can show you the world, but through their emotion, their experience. It's a language, and they all speak differently. I thought that was the most, well, I didn't think it, I felt it. Yeah. Later I went, okay, I know what it is.
Yeah.
And I just felt it, and I loved it. And so that's what it was. That's what made me want to do it. So I began to, strangely, in my, like, oh, I was in my 20s, I began to cartoon quite accidentally for a guy, a yachty. He was an ex-publican, ran the Randwick pub, and he had gotten, I mean, he was an alcoholic, and he decided to go dry out. So he went to sea with his girlfriend, and I met him, and he was like, I'm going to write books. You can draw. Why don't we, you know, do this together? And so he started writing articles, and I cartooned for him. I didn't realize I could do that. I just drew some drawings, and I was like, oh, they're funny. So published in a boating magazine, and so I really accidentally became a cartoonist and realized that I could get paid. So for a while I really kind of went down that road, and I still wanted to, but my, you know, my heart really lay with picture books. And so it was all through probably late 20s into my early 30s, I really began to try to push in that direction.
Yeah. And the cartooning somehow, I think, possibly I'm making an assumption here, but the cartooning, did that sort of lead you into educational publishing? Because you did a lot of black and white illustration for educational books, which is where I first met you.
Yeah, I've got in the attic, up in the ceiling space, I've got still containers of all the educational publishing illustrations. They're just loads. Because, look, it wasn't good pay, but it was something.
It was something, yeah.
Yeah, and I did a lot of it. Yeah, exactly.
And would you say that you were honing your skills while you were doing that too? Did it help?
Yeah, probably did, absolutely. Because, you read the material, you think, how shall I illustrate that?
Yeah.
That's it.
So you're in the zone, but, and you're practicing.
Yeah, that's right.
And so then your first picture book, well, won the Crichton, and that was Grandma's Shoes.
Yeah.
And what was that experience like? Was that exciting for you, or was that?
It was incredible. I absolutely did not expect that. I had no idea that was even a thing. And to explain, my husband was working a fisher in Playful, and at the time shift work and all hours and all this stuff. And I really, it wasn't, you couldn't call him at work, if you know what I mean. But I only called him at work twice in our, and that was once to say I was pregnant. The other time was to say I'd won the Crichton Award. Yeah.
Get it? Our community get that. Totally. Absolutely. It's very much an equal thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And do you think that got you noticed?
It did. I began to, I felt a little more encouraged that I could maybe call publishers. And so I remember calling Alan and Unwin from Brisbane to see if I could, connect with an art director and say, so I actually called and said, hi, I'm Caroline Magerl. I've just won the Crichton. And the lady put me through to an art director, but she said, oh, it's Mrs. Crichton. For you. And I'll...
So do you think that the industry then, had they pigeonholed you as a black and white, just as Mitch Vane calls it sometimes, a wrist, a wrist for hire, did they realise what beautiful art you could do, like your watercolour work? Did they even make that connection? And I feel like I feel like the Crichton Award might have, dropped the veil a little bit and made people go, oh, Carolyn's so much more than what we've thought.
I made a lot of effort to show my versatility. I used to make a lot of copies of my work, send out folios of my works, postcards, things like that. I'd go to Sydney initially on the bus, then eventually I would fly down, and I'd go around the publishing houses, go to Melbourne, do all that. Yes, they knew, but the problem is that I would be told that I was too versatile. They didn't quite know what to do with me. When I won the Crichton, what happened was I suddenly had a brand, and I began to get a lot of texts that were similar in sort of emotional weight. It was almost as if sad stories, Caroline, Caroline's your girl, which fair enough. But look, I suppose what I had to learn was it's not about all your abilities. It's how are you useful? And how do you transfer your skills into something that they can use? I think branding is part of the problem. It's like a recognizable style, and that's probably what they were more interested in, was like, okay, well, people will know you for this, and that's kind of where we're going to slot you. I was very versatile because I had to make a living. So I could do political cartoons. I almost became a political cartoonist for a period. I could do airbrush architectural renderings, which I did for a large yachting firms, so very precise and very accurate, realistic portrayals. I could do portraits, caricatures. I caricatured I did that. I actually did that for about 2 years at nightclubs. I could do a lot of stuff because I had to, like writers do. You know,
yeah.
You need to be nimble to survive. And but I thought that was a strength, but it wasn't. It was not a strength. What perhaps would have been a strength is me going, this is what I do, and I'm going to ride that horse.
That's fascinating. I'm sure this is fascinating for the younger or the aspiring illustrators that are coming up through the ranks now to hear that and to, you know, take what they need from that experience.
The problem is your art meaning business, and yes, something you would know about, and something that is a bit of a shocking thing to realize you need to learn a whole other world that has very little to do with what you think you're good at. So
yeah,
that's it. And that's any business.
Yes, yeah.
Not what you think necessarily.
Yeah. It's an amazing journey that you've been on, really amazing. Because it was quite some time then from, did you do many picture books between Grandma's Shoes and Hazel and Rose? Did you do any PBs in there?
Yeah, I did. I did one for Alan Bailey.
Castles, that was beautiful.
Yeah, no, that was fun. And what else did I do? My Grand's Different, Sue Lawson.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to think. I did Over the Moon for Libby Haythorne. I did quite a lot of just other, you know, like Aussie Nibbles, Aussie Bikes, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I was beginning to get more work in the trade area. And so some of my black and white, like for Tish and Silk, for example, so a colour cover, but black and white internals, that sort of thing. So and I just did it. I also was working for a really quite a large number of just, companies, magazines, all that sort of stuff.
You had a lot of steady gigs in there, didn't you, with some of the magazines, with the boating magazines and stuff. It was sort of like your white goods money.
Yeah, exactly. And I had an agent, and I started working for English publishers, Oxford Uni Press and Simon & Schuster, covers for adult novels, that sort of stuff. So I began to really, I was all over the place trying to find, and I was starting to, I actually was making a living, but it meant I had to spread myself very thin.
Yeah.
Not sure that was sustainable.
Yeah. I feel like with you, just from knowing you personally, and I'm not sure if this is exactly what happened, but it feels like there was a point where you said, you know what, I'm going to write my own picture books. I'm going to, this is what I'm going to do from here on in. And I do remember from experience from speaking with the publisher one time and her saying, I was saying something about Caroline Magerl and she was saying, oh, no, Carolyn's only concentrating on fine art now. So there was rumors getting out there in the world and we're all going, what's Caroline going to do next? And how's she going to funnel this in? Or, you know, rein in this enormous talent, you know, because that's been part of your challenge is being so talented in so many areas and then having to distill it down. So there were rumors getting out there that you were leaving the industry, that you were only focusing on fine art and et cetera, et cetera. But there was a point where you decided to write, I'm sure.
Yeah. Look, I think probably moving from Brisbane was one turning point because I began to, suddenly I found I really wanted to paint. And strangely, I found that was beginning to actually make me a living and it was supporting my picture book ambitions a little bit, you know. I had to find
the money. So when you say paint, what were you painting?
I was painting figurative oils and it was pretty serious. I was pretty serious. I'm still serious about it, but you can't have it all. You can't, you know, you just can't. And I think I had to make some choices. Hard. It's hard. It was hard actually putting that aside, but I still paint and that's okay. That's cool. You know, I'm glad I'm doing it and I paint portraits for people. You know, I still have my little painting world, but it's my own little off to the side thing that I do and I enjoy it. It's got nothing to do with picture books. It's just a different thing. for me. So basically when I moved to Umundi, that started to actually really ramp up. And I began to leave behind quite a lot of my commercial work and the magazines and all the stuff that I used to do. I started letting it go, and painting took up the income side of things for me for a while. And I also, a few things happened that made me realize that perhaps being an illustrator was emotionally problematic, because you don't really, you have to some degree just, you're there when people need you, and then you go back into your box and then you come out again. If I wanted to sell the illustrations, for example, it's a problem, because it's someone else's idea, someone else's thing, and that's fine. But I think that it was becoming a problem for me, and I needed to sort that out. So I withdrew from illustrating. It's true, for quite a while.
Yeah.
And also I wanted to write, and I was incredibly terrible. Oh, it was so hard. It was so hard. And writing for me was so difficult. It was like a voice that I just couldn't get out. As I said, I'd stopped, and it wasn't there for me. It felt so strange. And then in some ways maybe that self-imposed exile was a good thing, because it made me eventually, grow another limb. It feels like I've grown another limb. To write is to have something else, another ability.
You needed that time to find your voice as a writer. Yeah, yes. literally, yeah. And boy, did you find it though. Holy shit. Yeah. You're a beautiful writer, a beautiful writer. And
what happened.
And it's a complete package. You know, your books are a complete package. They're exquisitely written, and they're exquisitely illustrated, and it just comes together in this beautiful, you know, crescendo of loveliness. God, I'm a shit critic. But they're deeply experiential and emotional. So you found your stride, and that was with, hang on, let me get up for a sec. So this was the one that was so, amongst a lot of us, you know, in the industry, it was so anticipated, you know, like we were just hanging, hanging for this to come out. I literally remember one day being in Penguin and looking at roughs with one of the editors, because she was just busting to say, Carolyn's roughs are coming in, and we're just, you know, beside ourselves. And this was such a beautiful debut. Such a beautiful Hazel and Rose, beautiful debut. And did that give you confidence then to keep going? Did you feel a bit reassured once this came out that you could then?
I think that it took 10 years to write, 275 words, I think it was. I remember walking around a park in Canberra, trying to organise my thoughts and ask myself, what's this story about? Why does it mean so much to me? And I began to cry, and I thought, no, now I know what writers feel like. Oh, the drama. probably taught me a lot, taught me how I write.
Mm.
That was the thing. Mm-hmm. I just learned a lot and went through probably all my demons, which is, you know, anytime you do anything, you'll meet the same demons. Met the same ones, you know, in the other area of enterprise, same ones. So that was probably what it taught me. And it's a painful lesson, because, you know, everything that stops you, everything that you find, you know, you find difficult, all your self-sabotaging, all this stuff that, you know, that you don't even know that's going on in your head, it'll teach you. And so that's what Hazel and Rose was. And did it make things easier? Well, not necessarily. Because every book's different. Every book is a different thing. And
and up come the demons again, and here we go again.
Yeah, exactly. And you have to, you have to, I think other people have said this, it doesn't necessarily get easier, but what you do learn strategies, and you learn to get around yourself when you know that you're doing some of those things that you do,
There's that familiarity which can really help dispel the horror of it.
So you begin to grow skills like you do in art, where, you know, yes, it's a creative pursuit, but in the end it's the habits and the built-up skills you have that carry you forward. You need to have you can't rely on chance and intuition and inspiration. Those things are really important, but they are where it starts, which is what piano fingers is kind of about.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but having watched, Jen go through, my daughter go through music, and watch other children go through all their stuff, you notice certain things that are common to us all and common to us even as adults.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Which leads me a little bit in more into your process, because I know there'll be a lot of illustrators who are listening to this who are just really interested also in the physical process of what you do. So can you explain to us what, in terms of a picture book, what materials you use, what comes first, words or images, or is it a big conglomeration of everything? Can you just walk us through a little bit that? Well, we could use piano fingers if you like, because let's distill it down. Hang on a tick. We'll probably edit all this out of me getting up and getting down. But this is Caroline's new book, beautiful new book, only just come out with Walker Books, called Piano Fingers. Now, I'm thinking it's watercolour and ink.
Yes, it is. My husband's passing me. There you go.
Beautiful.
In case I need to show
you. Yes, yes.
Well, yes, it's watercolour, but there's also pencil and a little bit of ink. I play around a lot. You can tell by the mess behind me that I am a messy creator, but there is method in my madness. So what happened with Piano Fingers was that at the very start, I think ideas are what lie behind everything. They lie behind art and they lie behind words. Ideas are the connector, and emotion. Those two things are what really push you into the next phase, where you begin to shape. How's it go? Art without intellect is shapeless, and intellect without heart is lifeless, something like that. Anyway,
okay.
Yeah, it's just an interesting way of looking at it. You need the emotion, and then you need to shape. And the shaping part is the part that I find hard, because I have a crazy brain which kind of goes 360 degrees, everything's amazing, oh my God. Life is so weird and wonderful, and I can't think now. That's me. That's where I start. There's an insight. Anyway, I'm not really focused. It's strange. I am capable of focus, but when I'm in that space,
So for you, would you say to get to that, because clearly you are focused, you have an enormous body of work, but in order to get to that point, is that where the challenge is for you?
Yeah, hugely, because there's always something interesting. There's always ideas. There's always a sense of, oh, here's something that I could develop or do. It's what happens after that. So with Piano Fingers, the emotion and the impetus was all around watching my daughter start to learn to play piano. And there was a lot of emotion in that, because it was probably the thing that she glommed onto, music. Music moved her. Music was a thing. So her friends, like horse riding, whatever, music was Jen. And, she was, that was actually watching her grapple with something that was important to her and having to go through that process and the practicing and the discipline and all that stuff, you know. So
even a piano fingers reflects that finding the perfect instrument for you. That's just for you, that period of
usually. I mean it's actually personalities. It's almost like the wizard and the wand thing, you know what I mean?
It is not always clear why the wand chooses the wizard or whatever. It is not always clear why the piano chooses the child.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm convinced of this because, I mean, I know people, they're potters, right? Couldn't be anything else but potters. They're potters. That's what they do. It's in them. Anyway, so she was, it was strange because she kind of, the piano was, well, she had the xylophone and this and that. And then the piano just, we just decided, oh, well, you know, she likes music. Why don't we, so we bought this old piano just sitting over there and she began the lessons and, you know, she actually went through the thing. But strangely, after a while, it was obvious that the clarinet, she liked woodwinds. And so strangely, in the end, you know, after she'd actually got to the point where she was nearly at the point of going to the conservatorium and making that, you know, as a clarinetist, and she could have done it in piano too. She'd gone through all the exams and stuff. The clarinet is the thing that's probably closest to her heart, but the piano is still, you know, she loves it. And she still, when she's here, she plays it. It's beautiful and I love hearing it. But it was watching her go through that yes. made her want to write. And the character of the cat, of Maestro Gus, it all happened because there are three scratches on the piano, on the foreboard. And so obviously whoever had owned that piano had a cat. And weirdly, after years of sitting, watching her play, I always felt a presence of a cat. There was a cat. And so almost in a ghost in the piano situation, Maestro Gus became haunted our piano and became a character in the story quite intuitively. And it was then that I realised what Maestro Gus meant and what the relationship was between Maestro Gus and B. And so the narrative went forward in that way. It was all about each of these characters and what they represent. Gus was very much that it's the moment when you want to do something and you begin to dream. That's Gus. That's who he is.
That he's that personified, that moment personified.
That's who Gus is. He's that. He's that moment. And it's a very important moment because people don't even necessarily see it in their children. You don't know it. You might not have, you know, when you were a kid, did anyone know what your dreams were necessarily? Not necessarily. You don't say that. You know, that's who Gus is. And so the ghost in the piano, that, you know, Gus emerged from three scratches on the piano.
And Caroline, at what point in the process of writing the story did Gus emerge? Because I'm sure it wasn't right at the beginning, or was it?
No. It actually was, strangely, it was two girls fighting, and it was two sisters. And for a while, they were kind of just these two girls kind of battling it out. One could play and one couldn't. And so that, when after a while, I left that, and then it was just the girl and a cat. And eventually, when I went to properly write the narrative, that's when Isla, the older sister, came in, because Isla was what B would become. Isla was the maturity that B would need to eventually play piano. So those three were that little sort of drama. It was almost like a little play. That's how I saw it.
Yeah, the triangle. each of them a corner of the triangle. Yeah. And Isla is a beautiful character. She's not an adversary. She's not an enemy. She's just getting on with her own thing, and she's someone for to look up to, for B to look up to and aspire to. Yes, almost like B had to find her essence. The cat, you know, like I love that the personification of of the muse, of the turning point. It's a gorgeous, exquisite book. The other thing that I really just want to flag with you too is how you play with perspective. I don't know, you just do really, really beautiful, amazing stuff with perspective. There's never anything flat in any of your drawings. There's always so much movement and so much, there's surprises and I don't know, you're so adept with perspective. Does that come from some of that architectural drawing that you referred to, do you think? Or is it just more intuitive?
I think you have to know the rules to break the rules. And you kind of, people have said, you know, it's so wrong, it's so right, you know, it's wrong, but in a right way. And also it's what I said earlier about the language of illustrators, that they show you the world, but through the lens of emotion and meaning. So the piano is huge. Well, of course it's huge, and of course it's weird. Well, because when you're little, you know, everything everything is it's sort of emotionally out of proportion. You know, you remember what the world.
You do that. You do that so beautifully in Admire and Cat too. You know, the parents are enormous. Which is how they are. That's how we see our parents when we're children.
Yes.
They're huge.
I know.
The proportions, and she's so tiny and vulnerable up on the shoulder, and it really showcases her loneliness even more, you know.
Yeah. I've got a drawing of myself that Jennifer did, and it was it's a tiny, tiny head, and then I realized, oh, it's because you're down low. That's what it is. But first of all, I looked at it and went, oh. Anyway.
No, I love it. I love your style. I love what you do. I love the emotion. Your palette's quite distinct.
Oh, okay.
Is that intentional, or is that just do you just go with that, or do you select a palette before you begin, or do you reach for things as you're going?
Yeah, best intentions. I lay out the tubes, and then all the other tubes get dumped on the table.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I try. I do actually plan. I really do a lot of preparatory drawing, and I do plan the way the colours will be used and where and how that will work over the whole course of the book. So yes, there is there's a lot of messing around, but I eventually, because you really do need to nail things down, otherwise you risk confusion. For example, with Meyer and Cat. Using it's a very, very small girl in a very big landscape. So that big feather boa that she wore was yellow, and it always trailed behind her, and it pointed to her. That was very deliberate. You know, it's fun and flamboyant. There's a reason.
It served a purpose. Yeah,
it's a purpose. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. So there's method in the madness.
Gorgeous. I love that feather boa. I noticed in Piano Fingers that B is always in that really deep emerald green. And to me that was kind of a different. Sorry,
green with envy.
Yeah. Right. And I felt like that was a different colour for a Caroline Magerl palette, and I really love it. I love the way it pops, green with envy. I love that. I love it. And so Gus is wearing red. Is that some kind of passion, or, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Pop.
Yeah. Is there more you'd like to share with us about Piano Fingers? Because it's a very exciting thing to have a new book out. I know that. Are you off on a tour with it? What's going on? Oh, look, sorry, I'm like you. I've got a million questions. Chris Beadle.
Yes.
Let me backpedal a bit. Tell us about who is Chris Beadle and what is your connection there, and how did it develop? And you're going back there, aren't you?
I am. I'm going in April. Yeah. Well, the end of this month. So what happened was that I was in London and I was exhibiting at a gallery, oil paintings, so a portrait and some other stuff. And I met a lady who'd run.
When was this, Caroline?
Ooh.
About.
5 years ago.
Okay.
Five years ago, something like that. Yeah, so it was just, yeah, actually, it was just around the time, 2014. Sorry, so a bit longer than that. Anyway, 2014. So Hazel and Rose was just about to be published, and I met this lady. She was in, she ran a bookshop in the High Street in Kensington, and she was considered quite a figure. She was in a beautiful homes in Holland Park. Anyway, someone introduced me to her and said, hey, you should go talk to her. And so I walked through Holland Park in my UGG boots because it was really cold, and I got to her house, and it was white wool carpet. And I was like, forgot about my boots. Anyway, and I was met at the door by somebody let me in, and I didn't think about my – anyway, I traipsed three flights leaving leaves and stuff all the way. And then I looked back and I went, oh, no. And the lady said, oh, don't worry, it's fine, it's fine. And so I went and I met this lady and I had a cup of tea with her and showed her some of my work. And she said, you know what, you should talk to Chris Beatles. And I went, okay. So I went back to my apartment and I Googled him, and up came this picture. He looked Dickensian, you know, had the mutton chops. And
yeah.
I didn't realise that he'd actually been on TV. He was a comedian. He made comedy shows. So he was actually in the theatrical world to explain the picture, because it was pretty stagey, you know. And I was like, oh, okay. It was interesting, a little bit scary. Anyway, I didn't. This gallery, you have to make an appointment or you ring the bell. You know, it's not open. It's just how they do it. Anyway, so I showed up and I didn't have an appointment. I was too scared to, and I thought I may not even press that button. I might not even do it. I'm just going to stand here. And it's right behind the Ritz, so sort of in one of the back alleys behind the Ritz Hotel. Anyway, as I stood there, a woman just breezed past me and pressed the button, and the bell rang, and someone came up the stairs, opened the door, and she went in, and I just kind of like, oh, I'm just going. Why not?
It's like the movies.
Yeah, it was really. And anyway, it was probably the moment that really was quite important moment, really, because the next minute Chris Beatles came in front of me and he was like, hello. And I was like, oh, it's you.
Talk about synchronicity.
Man.
did he have the mutton chops and stuff?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh. Alarming. he was really nice. He was really kind and quite welcoming. And he could see I was an artist, which was even more extraordinary because, you know, sometimes you show up at a gallery with your portfolio under your arm and they get the fire hose. You can do that. And he said, oh, well, okay, you're from Australia. And, you know, we chatted and he said, show me what you've got. And I showed him the unpublished, the printed up version of Hazel and Rose that, you know, when they said, what's it, the folded and gathered.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, oh, look, okay, when it's published, just get back in touch with me. And so I did. And then he said, okay, well, send the originals. And so I did, and he put them in his catalogue, and he exhibited the originals with the yearly Illustrators show in November, which is a big sort of thing, and it's a big buying opportunity. Lots of collectors come and buy art and illustrations, cartoons, all that stuff.
Because it is an extraordinary gallery, isn't it? It's like
it's amazing. Quentin Blake and Helen Quentin
Blake, yeah. So you dropped out there. So what were some of those bigger names?
John Birmingham and Helen Osprey and a lot of very famous English cartoonists and also fine artists. Some of my heroes.
So in really good company.
Michael Forman's work is there. Just a lot of the, he deals in illustration. So now,
Caroline, when that Hazel and Rose exhibition was on, did you go over for that?
Yes, I did. I went over for it, and it was an amazing moment. I always wanted to have my art in a gallery, and it happened in a very weird way. I mean, a good London gallery, a really good one. So it was really cool, and I just couldn't quite believe it. It was actually quite surreal. And I went to the event. I was standing across from the Ritz Hotel, I remember, dressed, ready to go to the thing, and it was evening and it was all lit up because it was Christmas, you know. So it was beautiful. Piccadilly was all lit up. And I was just standing there waiting for the lights to change, and a bus pulled up, and the bus driver was just idling, and he looked at me. He was looking at me. I realised he was staring at me, and he went like this, and I realised that I was beaming. I was just smiling. I was like, hey, lady. And I was like, hi. Everything's so cool right now.
Hi, literally, I am high.
Yeah, he laughed. He actually laughed at me and then drove off. And I was like, I didn't even realise how happy I was feeling. I was like, this is incredible. So I went down there. I had a great night. I sat next to Chris Beatles at dinner afterwards, and I didn't say a word to him because I didn't believe this was happening. And I admitted it to him years later. I said, do you know why I never spoke a word to you that night? Because I didn't want the bubble to pop. Because this isn't happening. So, yeah, it was huge.
Wow, wow. And so then, of course, that led to, to a relationship with that him and with that gallery. And so Piano Fingers, where does it sit in terms of Chris Beatles' gallery?
So, yeah, so it's being launched. The book is being launched there on the 12th of April. And all the art will be up on the walls. Some of it's already been purchased. So some of it's gone into collections already. It's cool. It's
so exciting.
Yeah.
Is Chris Beatles, does this have a bookshop attached to it, or do they get a bookseller in? I know this is a really boring question, but I'm really interested in how you say it's going to be launched there. So I'm assuming they're selling copies.
So he will publish books about some of the artists he represents.
But the actual picture book? Do Walker send over a truckload of books or?
No, he's ordered some from Walker UK. So Walker UK are publishing Fingers, and he'll just bring in some for to have on
hold. For the night, yeah.
I sign and he just keeps them there. So, yeah, he does publish himself, but not picture books. It's about the artists and, collections and whatever, so that it's to do with the gallery and the gallery's operations. Yeah, that's the area that he has actually written a book on Louis Wayne, though, which is out. So that's the artist who did all those cats, the amazing cat pictures.
Oh yeah. They had a film about him.
Exactly, the electric life of Louis Wayne. So
yes, so fascinating.
Yeah, I saw.
So this is an extraordinary experience. It's just so wonderful. And you're heading over there in April.
Yes, I'm going again, and I am going to spend my time possibly, hopefully, painting bookshop windows and going from bookshop to bookshop and talking to people and having some fun in between. So it's going to be amazing. Yeah, it'll be fun. It'll be exhausting but fun.
Is Mark going with you?
Yes, he's coming this time. Yeah, which is great. Give him a chance to he'll visit Jen, and I'll be doing my thing. So it'll be cool.
Beautiful. How are we going for time? 11:30. Oh, so we're getting right. Gosh, that's gone fast, that hour. I'm just looking back here. just to bring it right back to Girl and Duck and the whole ethos of Girl and Duck, I just want to finish up by asking you the classic, what sort of tips have you got for emerging and aspiring illustrators? Anything that you particularly want to share? I know they will have taken a lot from just listening to you. You've been very generous with your experience, but is there anything like that, anything that you wish you had known back then, or anything about the current world of illustrating? Just anything you'd like to share?
I think picture books are, and children's books are, on an upswing. I think we are in a time when perhaps our art form is going to be more acknowledged. I think so. I do.
Wow. That is so encouraging. I love hearing that.
No, I think it's, you know what, and it's been almost like my secret agenda to make that a reality, because what we do is amazing and what we do has an enormous impact. So people who want to do this, I say it is an honourable and brilliant way to live your life. Do it.
What I say? I want that badge, brilliant and honourable. No, yeah. I love it. That is so, I love to hear that positivity come out, because so often you hear about, and we all do, and we all talk about it, it is hard. It's a really, really tough industry. It's a tough game that we're playing. It's long. It's a long game, all the things. But also there is this positive side. And you are an example of someone who's done it your own way. You've done it on your own agenda. You've found the adventure in it. I love that about you. You've found the adventure in something that could be, that can be a very, very, you know, hermit-like existence. You've found that other side of it where, you know, went up to that doorbell. It's such a beautiful metaphor. You approached the doorbell, still not even knowing if you were going to press it or not, but literally opened a door.
And that probably is the self-belief side of it, which is a very easy term to throw about. But in the end, it feels terrible, but you do it anyway. No one's given you permission. No one's told you you can. No one, you know, it doesn't matter to people whether you follow your dream or not. I mean, apart from your family or your friends, you know, but really, in the end, you choose yourself, and you have to, you know, that under those circumstances, if that's the case, then you must do whatever you need to do to support yourself emotionally and to bring your gift to the world. And the world eventually, you know, should be damn well grateful. Because we make a huge difference. I've not changed my position on that. Yeah. Not at all.
No, if anything, it's strengthened. I can see that from knowing you for so many years.
We are all campaigners now.
The old war horses. Caroline, that's been such a fun interview. I just took so much from that. I can't wait actually to see the replay so that I can just enjoy it as a punter rather than as the interviewer. Because there's just so much gold in there, so many gems. I love hearing about your story and all the nuances of it. I love the bravery and the way that you've just, you know, you've made your own rules and gone out there and done things that...
from one to another, you know, you've done the same, and you've actually brought a lot of benefit to a lot of people. So that's something that, you know, I'm just going to say... You were the one person I remember being very, very honest with me and very, very helpful at times when I needed it. So that was before you started the duck pond. So it was like in your blood. A little thank you.
My absolute pleasure. It's been an honour to be involved with you and to watch you grow and flourish and to see your art and your words coming out into the world. Absolutely a joy for me. So thank you so much. It was so great to catch you before you jump on the big silver plane and fly away again. We will be watching very closely to see how things on the Instagrams and the whatevers, to see how it all goes over there in April, knowing that it will go beautifully, of course.
And fingers crossed.
And then we'll be looking forward to, as they always say, what's next. But but we will be looking forward to that. And we will get together again and speak about what is next and what happens as we go along. That'd be wonderful.
Thank you, Jen.
Thank you so much, Caroline. Bye for now. Have a great day. Stay out of the floods. Bye.